Hello. Hi. I'm afraid I don't actually have a PowerPoint presentation, so you're just going to have to rely on me. As said, I am a filmmaker. I've been working in TV for about 10 years. I started off making stuff for National Geographic about things that sort of explode and crash into each other and stuff like that. And then worked on Grand Designs and a few of those sorts of series. And I really enjoyed it. I really enjoyed that sort of stuff and thought it was quite fun working in telly. But then I got an opportunity to work as an assistant producer on the first series of 24 Hours in A&E. Which was quite a while ago now. And actually, I saw in that the opportunity to tell some stories that felt maybe a little bit more important than how nice your house was or how things go bang. And so I became a bit more interested in maybe tackling social issues a little bit more. And then about a couple of years after that, I got approached by an executive producer to come and work on a series that was about the South London and Maudsley Trust. Through the work that they'd done with Kings on 24 Hours in A&E, they gained access to do some documentaries with different services within SLAM. And I went for this meeting, and I thought it was quite interesting and a good opportunity, but then it sort of really struck me on the way home that it's sort of something that we really don't talk about that much, and I knew absolutely nothing about mental health services. And I sort of thought I didn't know anything about mental health, and I thought, well, you know, actually, sort of one of my siblings has struggled her whole life with mental health problems, and we don't even talk about that as a family. You know, I don't talk to her about it, let alone talk to sort of my friends or colleagues. So it might be quite interesting for me personally, but also quite important to make a series where we just tackle that head on, and we're not afraid of it, and we don't sort of try and apologise for the fact that we're making a series about mental health and sort of couch it in too much sort of apologetic language, and that we give people an opportunity to be themselves and give them a voice, and that they sort of can celebrate their lives as much as show the challenges that they face. So we started out to try and make this series that ended up, and the title wasn't my choice, being called Bedlam. I suppose we wanted to make films that had something to say, that were quite sort of bold in what they tackled, but that also didn't exploit the people that were in them, which unfortunately is something that television does far too often. And that has then been the model for films that I've tried to make since, really, and I've gone on to make a few, and as been mentioned, it's been sort of lucky in that they've been well received by people. So I thought I might show you some clips from some of the films that I've made recently. I've done two series that have been specifically about mental health. One of them is Bedlam, another one has just been on TV called Kids on the Edge, both for Channel 4, but also a couple of series that have touched on the same subject in different ways. And then I thought maybe I could talk through a bit about the people that are in them and what I sort of learnt as an observer by making them.
Would you like people to understand you?
Yes.
Increasingly, our children are struggling to navigate today's complex world.
I was born a male.
They've called me a psychopath, they've called me crazy.
With exclusive access to one of the UK's leading mental health trusts.
The children that come here deserve to be helped.
A new groundbreaking series explores the challenging issues facing our nation's young minds.
There's a line between insanity and sanity, and I have no idea where I'm at.
I feel like I'm just gonna burst.
I'm never gonna stop being who I am.
It's like you're on the edge of a cliff and someone just pushes you off.
Kids on the Edge.
And this place is just getting worse now.
No, I'm quite worried about you at the moment.
No, I ain't going to no hospital, I'm fine.
You don't want to go there?
Oh no. Oh no. I want to move out of here.
I know.
That's what I want. I want to live a normal life.
I suppose it's better I know, because that was my son and I have to deal with that.
Well, that's obviously a baby, isn't it? Look how chubby those and little those legs are. These are level fours.
Was to hold back Al-Shabaab and prevent...
The more I find out about Al-Shabaab, the harder it is to understand how Thomas has gone down this path.
You go out with friends and it's like they don't want to mention it because they don't want to upset you. I suppose it's difficult because they don't know what to say or what to do. and I don't really know what I want them to say or do anyway. If he died, in one way, I suppose, oh God forgive me, it would be easier because then I know that he couldn't hurt anybody else. But no, it wouldn't be easier because my son would be gone. But then I guess my son has gone anyway.
Hello, Rosemary?
Go,
Okay, so we're going to complete section 3. We're just doing the papers now, and then take her to triage ward, Lewisham Hospital. Okay.
Section 3 of the Mental Health Act.
Was she sectioned last year or something?
She was sectioned last year, which was in October. Okay, Tom.
The paperwork.
Thank you very much.
Under Section 3, they can detain and admit Rosemary to hospital against her will for up to 6 months. Once in hospital, Rosemary will not have the right to refuse medical treatment. For those we'd met at the hospital, it wasn't so much about finding an absolute cure. It was about learning to deal with the anxiety and then staying on top of it. Although Helen was still struggling with her thoughts, she'd actually made it back to work.
How are you?
After 2 years of being stuck at home. She still hopes she can get back together with her boyfriend. Aaron's anxiety hasn't gone completely, but it doesn't dominate his life anymore, and he no longer hides it from those closest to him. As for James, 6 months on, he's returned to university in Exeter to redo the first year of his drama degree. So far, he's kept his OCD in check and is enjoying a life free of anxiety.
Right. See, this may seem a bit weird, but I'll just do it.
Thank you.
So that's I thought I'd finish on James there because James is a guy who's a sort of an actor and very funny and sort of very creative person who had found himself in his early teens starting to suffer from anxiety. They got to a point when he was about 15, 16, where he'd had to go into a residential unit. He'd attempted suicide. There were lots of things that were very challenging. It was manifesting itself in him not being able to leave the house at all. He was sort of terrified, basically, that he would sort of shit himself in public, which sort of, for even he would admit, would sound ridiculous, but I think it was, for him, that was the worst possible thing that could happen. And that meant that he never left the toilet, essentially. But it didn't take long before it became apparent that actually James's his sort of self-esteem issues and self-loathing issues had led him to think that actually he could be the worst thing that's possible. So he sort of... That would manifest itself if he went out and him shitting himself, but equally that he could be a paedophile, that he could be a necrophiliac, that he could be incestuous. So it was what initially looked like just quite a sort of creative but anxious young man, in fact was completely debilitated by his anxiety disorder. But over the process of about 5 months at the anxiety disorders residential unit, he was able to work with that and got to a point where actually he was able to live a sort of very normal life and was massively a sort of success story of our of their program, but also of our series. I mean, he was one of the people who, if you like, got better. Then I got a phone call from James about a month ago to say that he was back in the anxiety disorders residential unit. That he'd left there and he'd gone off to university, as we said in the film, and he'd done tremendously well at university. I'd stayed in touch. I'd gone to a couple of his plays. It was all looking really well. And then he'd finished university, and suddenly there wasn't that sort of there wasn't a plan for what to do. And he knew he wanted to get a job, but he didn't quite know how to do that. And suddenly that void had appeared in his life again. And for him, that always gets filled with his mental health problems. And I felt quite weird going down to see him at the anxiety unit, because I thought, is he going to feel like really ashamed and stuff? Because we'd left on such a positive point, and he had this film that we'd made that we all thought we were already proud of, and that showed him sort of being better, and he would talk as if he'd been cured all the time. But actually, he was sort of all right, and I was quite surprised by it. And what he'd realised, going back there the second time, was that he could sort of conquer this again, that there was a roadmap there for him to get better, and that there was sort of hope in sight. And I suppose what I'd learned across all of the programmes that I've made, that are on these sort of subjects, is that people can often lose sight of that, the ability that things potentially can be a bit better than they are now, and they can get stuck in their sort of catastrophizing, as the speaker said about earlier. And I thought that was actually a sort of really positive thing. So when I was starting to think of my big long list of things that I've learned through the documentaries that I've made about mental health, that felt like a really positive thing, that actually confidence and the confidence that things can be quite different to how they are now can have a massive impact. And that's something that I'll come back to in a bit. But to talk through a couple of the other people there, the woman who you see sitting on a sofa talking to her care coordinator at home, a lady called Tamara, she was somebody who had quite recently, after I met her, spent some time in a triage unit and then in an adult ward with psychosis. She took lots and lots of drugs all the time, lots of amphetamines, and she had a persistent delusional disorder around stuff that was living in her house. Now she lived I think everyone would sort of agree, a pretty grotty and horrid flat that she detested, and it was also the flat that she'd had her children taken away from her in, that still had all her children's stuff around her. It was also the flat that she believed was infested with bed bugs that would get under her eyes and start controlling her. And it was also a three-bedroom flat, and there was just her living in there. And it seemed to be a very sort of simple thing that maybe moving out of this flat would be quite a good idea for her generally, that her social and sort of mental well-being might increase by not constantly being reminded of what she's lost on a day-to-day basis because of her mental health disorder, but also just sort of sitting amongst what she would basically go and try and live in the corridor instead, rather than living in the flat, which every time that happened, the police would get called and she'd get taken back in and potentially would get sectioned again, and this sort of cycle would go over and over again. And she had the most amazing care coordinator, a guy called Jim, who was, I call him Saint Jim, because he seems to sort of just endlessly be able to give time and empathy to people. And Jim would give as much time as he possibly could to Tamara. But Jim had 25 people on his books, and he was supposed to talk to each one of those every day, every week rather, so he'd talk to 5 people a day, and Tamara would end up taking up sort of 2 days a week, and he had lots of other people that would end up taking up 2 days a week, so he'd end up working about sort of 20 days a week. But he was unable to get her moved, and it just sort of struck me that there's often not a lot of joined up thinking when it comes to stuff like this, that the sort of simple solutions that seem to be staring you in the face don't happen, and I can never understand why that is, and I still don't understand that today, especially when there was lots of people looking for three-bedroom flats. Then I put a couple in there, a couple of sort of clips in there that weren't, they're not about sort of mental health, they're not from mental health programs, but one of them's from a film called My Son the Jihadi, which is about a mother whose son, a sort of white British mother, whose son becomes radicalized not long, about sort of 2 years after converting to Islam. Sally, very pleased that that her son Thomas had converted to Islam because it was giving him a bit of direction in life. But actually, Thomas was an angry young man, a very vulnerable man. Because of that, was very vulnerable to people sort of turning that anger into something else. And what I found when I met Sally was somebody who'd essentially locked herself in her house for about 3 years and not spoken to anybody because she was so ashamed and so sort of full of guilt about the stigma of your son having done all these hideous things and continuing to do these hideous things. But actually, when you sort of stepped back and looked at it, when I stepped back and looked at it, I saw two very vulnerable people that actually, you know, Thomas was vulnerable to any number of things happening to him. And I'm sure if you looked through his sort of history and if you met him at different portions of his time, people probably could have diagnosed him with depression and anxiety and lots of sort of other things that were going on that were just completely missed and that led him in a different direction. But what that had led to was Sally being a tremendously unhappy person. But she would never, ever. So one of the things that I offered in our sort of, we do duty of care packages for all the people that we have on our shows, was to pay for counselling for her, because I thought she might need a bit of time to talk to somebody and she could choose what type of talking that would be and who she would spend time with and maybe think about. But she would refuse to believe in herself that she had any sort of mental health disorder, that this was just grief and it would be natural and that it would move on. I found that very strange, because she'd been so open in talking to me about so many other things, but she still wouldn't sort of accept the fact that her mental health might have taken a bit of a kick by the fact that her son had killed 90 people, which I just still sort of can't reconcile. So actually it just means that I talk to Sally on the phone sort of about 4 hours a week still to try and chat her through things. And then there's another clip, and it's probably not the best clip actually, from a series called 24 Hours in Police Custody. When I made that, I was sort of struck by a couple of things. One was that pretty much everyone who turns up at a desk in a custody unit, they're asked if they have any sort of diagnosed mental health conditions or if they would describe themselves as having a mental health condition. Now, I can't remember anyone who didn't say they did, and I found that sort of remarkable that they would be sort of offered help if they wanted it. No one ever asked for it. But it seemed that there are lots and lots of sort of intervention points in people's lives that don't get picked up on. And it seemed like a really extreme example. But I was also struck by the fact that loads of these coppers that I was working with, and those two that are in the clip were ones from the Child Safeguarding Unit, which is like the most horrific job you could possibly imagine. They're having to deal with really, really traumatic stuff and grade sort of images of child abuse all the time. And I said to them, so what sort of counselling do you get? Do you get some sort of time to offload about this? And they said no, that they're not offered anything, which is remarkable, isn't it? I mean, you talk about a sort of stressful work environment, and these are people who work for us, you know, who they work for the police, they work for a public organisation, and we really need them to do a fantastic job and to stop people being abused, and yet we're not giving them any sort of support in doing that. And when I spoke to their bosses, they said, oh no, it's there, you know, it's sort of provided, but the fact that these two people didn't think it was really shows you something. And then the other clip, the clip that we started with, I suppose all of the films that I'd made had I felt like I was just making films about people that were firefighting, that they everyone had got to a point where things had got really terrible and you were in crisis, and therefore you've just got to try and break people out of that crisis. But then to take them back to a position where actually they're doing quite well and not just in crisis, as soon as they get there, then the support might fall down. And actually, thankfully, because of organisations like The Bridge, that's not necessarily true. But unfortunately, for lots of the people I filmed, they weren't getting sort of picked up by other organisations. So they would just go back into crisis and back into crisis and back into crisis. So we had tried to make a series about CAMHS, about Child and Adolescent Mental Health Services, or a episode rather in Bedlam about that. And it was really difficult, because to make a documentary series about people with mental health problems and varying levels of capacity is really difficult. To do that with kids is like about as hard as you can possibly get. So we didn't manage to do it at that time, but I didn't give up, and more importantly, the commissioning editor didn't give up, and they found somebody else who was developing some access with the Tavistock unit. And we made a series, which in fact took them, including the research, took 5 years to make. Thankfully, I was only doing a year and a half at the end. Called Kids on the Edge, which looked at three different services within the Tavistock Centre. Now, one is not actually a mental health service, it's a gender identity service, but there were certainly lots of children going through mental health issues who were going to the gender identity development service. And then one was about a school for children with early trauma. Almost all of them had been through this sort of care system in one way or another, or had been through sort of bereavement or something like that, and were facing lots of problems as a consequence of their early experiences. And then the last film was about teenage girls. So similar to we've just heard about, there's a massive, massive rise in teenage girls turning up at accident emergency departments and their doctors and at schools being quite unwell, lots of sort of self-harming. And that was something, it was really interesting to hear being spoken about earlier, because I couldn't get my head around it, and I still can't quite get my head around why there'd be this massive rise. And I went to a school just for research, we didn't film there, where quite a few of the girls had ended up, year 10 girls, which I think is about 15, had ended up in a residential unit. And then lots were referring themselves to A&E, and I thought that's enormous. And of course, you always get sort of people feeding off each other and things becoming a bit of a trend. But I wanted to know why the teachers there thought it might happen. And they said that fundamentally they thought that we can't raise our children in the way that we have been raised by our parents. That things have moved on so dramatically in terms of how young people interact with the world that you can't just rely on the fact that when you send them to their bedroom, they're going to their bedroom and that's it. So it was really interesting to hear about the peer-to-peer stuff, actually, because I think that's a very sort of sensible solution to a problem like that. That maybe if I try and talk to, well, I did try and talk to these teenagers, about social media and how it works, I just sort of sound like an idiot who doesn't really understand it. And I am an idiot who doesn't really understand it. So if you try and tell them to sort of be safe and be sensible, it just doesn't have any sort of impact at all. But maybe someone who is literate in what they're talking about might have a bit of an impact. But I guess what we tried to look for was, in fact, three services that were doing well within it, rather than look at the fact that it's all failing, which lots of people tried to do all the time, was actually try and look at three things that were going quite well. And the thing that I found the most heartening out of probably everything that I've ever made was the episode about children with early trauma. Now, these were kids that the most sort of horrendous things had happened to them. They'd been through the sort of neglect or abuse that you don't want to sort of hear about or know about. It was horrendous. And all were acting out in really dramatic ways. And that's absolutely sort of understandable. And I thought, when you sort of hear these stories, you think, how can these kids ever go on to have a sort of happy and healthy life, to live the type of life that any of us would want to lead? And the reality is not easily, but you have to, all of the sort of stars have to align, and you have to spend a lot of time, not just like a session a week for 6 months, but these children would spend 30 hours a week in a specialist school that would then, it's not like lots of sort of units where it's a holding pen to hold kids until they can go to a slightly larger holding pen until you can put them in a prison. It's looking at how you can actually affect them, how you can work through. And it's quite painful. It doesn't look pleasant. You know, it's making children sort of think about and relive the most unpleasant things that have happened. But to get them to a point where they can understand how those feelings are affecting them and how they can make the right decisions themselves, not just telling them what the right decisions are, but how they can get to that place on their own. And it had a tremendous effect. And in fact, that film, it's called Last Chance School, is still online, and I'd sort of implore you all to watch it, because it's quite difficult and it's sort of full of lots of challenging behaviour. But actually, all the children do incredibly well at the end of it. And there's few things that have made me cry when I'm filming it, and that was one of them. But it went to show me that actually, even these children that have had sort of horrific upbringings, if you give them enough hope, and that's sort of you holding hope as the people that are working around them, but enough time, then actually the most tremendous sort of changes can happen. And if it can happen to them, then it can sort of happen to everyone. I know there's sort of stages in your life when interventions are easier than others, but it sort of gave me an awful lot of hope. So then I started thinking, what can I really say about what I've seen and what's been really positive and what's been really helpful that isn't like too specific. And I started to think, and this is me being a little bit big-headed, that most of the people that I'd filmed had got quite a lot better than they were at the beginning. And that wasn't just because it's sort of self-selecting and the doctors only give you people that are going to sort of end up getting better because they want it to be a good PR thing. But I thought, so I started to have a think about that. And the reality was that what I would do with everyone that I filmed is I'd spend a lot of time listening to what they have to say and sort of not judging them about it and sort of saying, actually, it's quite important what you're saying and people should listen to it and you should be quite confident in what you're saying and we should, you know, it will be a good thing to put this on television. It can help other people. And that sort of feeling that somebody is listening and that feeling that it's quite important what I've got to say can raise your confidence, and that confidence just bleeds out into everything else, into you wanting to take opportunities and you wanting to fill your life with other things. So it sounds sort of really maybe a little bit trite and really simple, but I think like the most important thing, and it's certainly something that I believe The Bridge does, is just to listen to people, and to sort of empathise and spend time with them, and that sort of human contact can be the best sort of medicine for anyone.
You work with quite vulnerable people.
Yes.
And it requires a lot of sensitivity. How did you go about dealing with that?
So to start with, I mean, you're right, they're about as vulnerable as sort of people can be, and you've got to, so you have to be led by some of the people around them to start with about whether it's even appropriate to talk to them in the first place or be introduced. So when you're working with an institution like a mental health trust, you're normally led by their clinicians and care coordinators. So that's the first thing, whether they think that person is robust enough to talk to you, even for your research. There's quite a lot of, at that point, managing people's expectations, because the last thing you want to do is say, I'm going to put you on TV, and then not, because that's a sort of really crushing thing. So we do that, we spend a bit of time with them, you know, we personally judge whether we think somebody is going to not just have capacity and all those sorts of things, but whether they're going to be able to deal with the process that comes afterwards about it being on TV and sort of everyone knowing about it. There's quite a lot of talking to all of their friends and family, or as much as they're happy for you to sort of see how much everyone knows to start with, and whether you're going to be putting something on TV that people don't know and that they might wish they hadn't done. There's also lots and lots of viewing stages, so they get to watch the footage, they get to watch the cut documentaries, they get to put input into that. Other people that they nominate can watch the documentaries, the clinicians watch the documentaries. And then, for instance, with James, the guy with anxiety disorders, with him, I was really personally very, very worried that putting him on TV might cause him to relapse and get really anxious, and that he might massively care about what everyone thinks, and that would cause a big problem. So sometimes there's very practical solutions. So for him, he didn't really care what sort of some bloke in Doncaster thought about him. He cared what the people that he knew thought about him. And not wanting to be sitting there at home thinking they're watching this and I can't see what they think about me, and if I'm waiting and they're not calling me, what does that mean? And so we just sort of, we just went for showing it to every single one of his friends that he cared about before it went on TV with him present, so he could be there and we could answer questions and we could talk about it. So there's lots of thought that goes in around it. There's also capacity tests that psychologists and psychiatrists and care coordinators and stuff will do with the individuals about whether they think they understand what they're saying yes and no to when they're talking about being involved in a documentary. And then there's lots and lots of other things that we do afterwards, that we part of the sort of managing the broadcast. And lots of that's just about being available yourself for those people around the broadcast time, before broadcast, after broadcast. Another thing that we had to do things a little bit differently with the young people, because there's a fear with young people that they weren't so concerned about with the adults, that they'd also be wanting you to be pleased. They'd just be wanting to please you, and they'd be wanting to please their clinicians and their parents and all these other people that thought it was a good idea. So we created sort of safe spaces, people that we weren't talking to, that weren't involved in the documentary, that they could go and talk to about this, but that could pass on concerns that they had through sort of intermediaries, so that young person knew that going talking to that person wasn't going to get back to me, because it soon becomes apparent to people that everybody in their life has contact with the producer. So lots of it is thinking about that stuff, because on a legal level you have to think about that, but more on a sort of personal moral level you have to think about it. There would be nothing worse for me and I wouldn't sort of be able to manage that, I think, than if I put someone on TV and it had a seriously detrimental effect on their life. I want this to be really positive for everyone. I want people to come out of it and then sort of, you know, 6 months' time, 10 years' time, to be really proud that they were involved in it and that it was something that was sort of good in their life, not something which they regret, which unfortunately is what happens lots of times. Not all TV's like that, and not all sort of, you know, articles and newspapers and, you know, all that. People work in different ways, but that's the way that we have, and actually that's the why you carry on getting invited back to places, because if you sort of do it properly, then it can be good, not bad, I suppose.
Thank you. I'm John Crowley. I work at the University of Greenwich with education programs for various health and social care. But you've raised lots of issues about capacity. Mm-hmm. And we were watching David Baddiel's program this morning about the trouble with Dad.
Yes.
And I guess he's brave, and I thought it was brave to almost challenge capacity.
Yeah.
Because I wonder what a society will ever start to understand some of the real challenges people have in distress.
Yes.
Unless we get over hiding and always wanting to be positive.
Yeah,
sometimes
yeah.
we have to see it dirty as well. And I just think that.
But I think maybe if, like, so actually the films. They have a positive message in them at the end, and we try to sort of end on a positive point, but they don't shy away from showing, as you see sort of people being sectioned and things, seeing the bits when people don't have a capacity. So we don't have, we can't cause distress by filming, and we can't, if someone asks us to stop filming, we'll always stop. People have to have capacity at the point where they watch the film and say it's okay. But you can film people who don't have capacity. I mean, I haven't seen the film yet, but I'm not sure how they managed it, because I'm sure he didn't have capacity at any point.
No, and that's what I was discussing with the three brothers. Was it ethically moral to film somebody who may not have capacity?
You see, that it becomes especially murky if one of them's a sort of television personality. I mean, it's difficult, isn't it? Because sometimes you want to show the sort of the hardest side of things, but it's just not possible. I mean, there were definitely people that we filmed for Bedlam that didn't make it into the final show, because we weren't able to sort of prove that, and we weren't equally, though you do have to stand back and think it's their life and it's not just a telly show. So if they genuinely don't have capacity or you can't prove that, you've got to err on the side of caution with them. I think, I mean, that's how I personally feel about it. So thanks very much.